Better Place Blueprint, a short podcast about how the world can be better, told by the people who are doing it now.
Hello, I'm Siobhan Hunt. I'm skating close to my 50s and have recently had the unbelievable good luck of being made redundant. I say good luck because if there was ever a time to get my shit together, it's now. And here's what I want to know. How do I make this next chapter of my working life count? How do I leave the world a better place than when I arrived? I hope to find the answer by talking to people who are doing it right now. In each episode, I'll speak to someone who's changing the world for the better. A little bit of hope in a world that can feel hopeless. This is a Better Place Blueprint. My guest today is Eileen Hall. Eileen has been practicing and teaching yoga for over four decades. She studied in India under BKS Iyenga and Pattabhi Jois, two legendary yoga masters. Yoga is a practice that changes the world through a ripple effect. If you yourself have practiced before, you'll know that it leaves you with a sense of peace that can make you a more pleasant person to be around. And if you dive a little deeper, it includes lessons on how to live gently and compassionately in the world. I started by asking Eileen what led her to this work.
Siobhan, you know, it's like how far do you have to go back? So, look, I was just writing a little story about yoga and food. And in that I had to go back in my memory, and I actually became a vegetarian when I was six. And no one in the house was a vegetarian. It was me just refusing one Sunday afternoon to eat the chops and sausages. And I ran out of the house. My father grabbed me and he said, go to your room and stay there and come out when you're ready to eat. Well, I came out and I was ready to eat, but I didn't sit at the table. I kept going into the backyard where we had fruit trees. So I sat and ate the fruit off the tree. And I did that for 2 weeks. At 6 years old. So I don't know when this path started, but I think there it might have been a turning point, a little bit of a turning point in just caring for others. And my thought then was caring for creatures. I didn't want to consume them. I didn't want to see them suffer. So I chose not to eat. That was the only reason I didn't want to eat meat. So probably at six, I'd say. And then when did I actually start doing practice of yoga? When I was 20 is when I had my first official yoga class. But I was also interested prior to that in meditation, stillness, inquiring of the mind, even at the age of 12. What's that book called? I'm Okay, You're Okay. I was reading that at the age of 12. I don't know if I made any sense, but it was a good title.
And at what point did you think, I want to be a teacher?
Oh, that never came from me. I wasn't interested in being a yoga teacher at all. It came from my teachers who would encourage me to help them, assist them. Another yoga teacher I had, she went away. She invited me to teach the class. So there was no desire for me to become a yoga teacher. I really thoroughly enjoyed being a practitioner and diving into that. So I guess it was when I'd spent numerous times in India with BKS Iyengar, and he would take me out of the pack of Western yoga students and he would have me assist him in class. And I really enjoyed that. I really enjoyed watching people heal, get better.
And would you say then that it's those mentors and teachers in your life that led you to the work that you've now been doing for decades?
Of course. If you have someone that you're aspired to, it makes the path so much easier, of course. And I've had brilliant teachers over my path, and I'm ever so grateful for them. So, yes, they've been my inspiration all the way along.
Was there a time when that realization kind of dropped for you that being a teacher would be your path and your purpose in life? Because if you started doing yoga when you were 20, I can't imagine that there were as many yoga schools in Australia then as there are now. So it was quite a, almost a, sounds like a different choice to make. Mm. What was that like at that time to think, okay, this is what I want to do? Did you have a moment of realization with that?
Oh, look, I can recall at the age of 20 starting yoga, and at the age of 21 I started assisting the teachers. So at 21 I was teaching. And then at about 22, 23, 24, I had part-time jobs because you could make money out of yoga teaching 45 years ago. It was not available. And then it was 1 year I went to India. I must have been teaching for 7 years, and I'm like, 7 years is about the time. If you want to change your career, this is the time you do it. You're not all that way in. You can really, like, learn another skill. So I actually went to an Indian astrologer in Mysore, Shankaranarayana, and he did my chart. And at the end of the reading, he said to me, is there any question you have? And I said, yes, Shankaranarayana. I just want to know, should I be doing this? Should I be teaching yoga? And he started counting all the houses. 1, 2, 3, 4. And he said, it's in your destiny. This is what you must do. And that was a huge relief, because then all the doubt goes away. It's just doubt that gets in the way of us following our path. So as soon as he removed that doubt, there was no fear anymore. The fear went. And it was a calling, and I pursued it.
Was there any time that you stumbled, whatever that might look like, as you walked this path?
Yeah, that would have been 20-plus years ago. I was diagnosed with cancer. That's a stumble in anyone's life. And you're left with the uncertainty. Will you survive this cancer or this disease, or will you not? And it actually brought up all the teachings for me. It was like, this is what you're practicing yoga for, to find out whether you're prepared to completely let go, and that's letting go of the body as well. And I wasn't prepared to let go of my body. So I stumbled for a bit, probably a year. I went away and did several Panchakarmas in India. And that's where they take you into a long detox, realigning, not just of your physical body, but also your spiritual body, your mental body. So they work with you, all of you, all aspects of you. And I came out of that. I did several Panchakarmas, maybe 5 or 6. Each one's about 6 weeks. Just so inspired, more inspired. So stumbling blocks actually become stepping stones. And I became more inspired to now incorporate more of an Ayurvedic lifestyle within the yoga. And you realise after a while that yoga and Ayurveda, they're inseparable. They have to come together when you go deeper into the path, into the practice.
That's definitely a huge stumbling block. Thinking about, obviously teaching yoga isn't just a career for you, it's a vocation. We can have a life of purpose and we can do the work that gives us purpose, but it can be hard to still live because we have the other things we have to pay for. We have to pay for the roof of our head, food, that sort of thing. Has there ever been challenges or, as I said, stumbling blocks in pursuing what gives you purpose because of those things?
Not once. Not once. Has that ever happened? I've had situations financially where I've really strapped for cash, but I find a way. No, it's my calling, and I will do whatever I can to help and teach people this practice.
Has this work changed you over the time you've been teaching?
Oh, that's a hard question to answer, because how do you know how you'd be without it? So I don't know. Look, I'd probably be living out west with three kids and, you know, driving a Mazda or something. I don't know. I have no idea. But certainly, yes, it has changed me because what I eat, what I read, where I go on holiday. Well, I don't holiday. I'd go to India. So that's, well, it is a holiday. It's a break from teaching, but I go there to become a student. So everything I do is based around the practice for yoga. So yes, of course, it has changed me. But what would I be doing if I hadn't done yoga? I have no idea. The yoga becomes everything you do. You get up early. I wake at 3. I go to bed early and I make sure I don't eat too much at night so that I can wake up and be ready for my practice and be prepared for the students that come in so I'm not sluggish. I don't drink alcohol. I don't eat meat. I don't take any psychedelic drugs. So my life's pretty pure so that I can be aligned and attuned to passing on the knowledge.
And because you've spent your life looking at all sorts of bodies and when they're going through postures, can you see when people hold their emotions? Can you see it in their bodies and when they're practicing?
Of course. Yes. Of course. It's like, I've often said it before, it's like me looking at a Dalmatian dog. I just see the spots all over them.
And what kind of change have you seen? You have so many students, but do you ever get to see the impact of your teaching?
Well, they tell me. They tell me it's impacted their life, for sure. I mean, I only see them in the yoga room. I don't see them in the house. I don't see them how they interact with people. But certainly I encourage people to never roll up their yoga when they roll up the yoga mat. So you want to be able to take that practice through all of your life. And, yes, when it comes to, you know, end of year, Christmas, there's a tremendous amount of love and gratitude that comes back and people tell me how it's impacted them and changed their life.
I know that you have had students who've also been through cancer and I imagine that that requires a different kind of approach as a teacher, but also emotionally when you're seeing, helping someone through that if they're on the mat. And how was that for you in that experience?
Oh, look, I think we're all going to come across some big hurdle in life. So for cancer people, people with all sorts of mental illness, financial problems too, that can cause a lot of issues for people. It's about having empathy for them and having had a disease myself, you can relate so much better with people, certainly. But the teacher's role is to hold the student steady in the midst of all the turmoil that's going on for them. And that's my role, is to make sure that I continue working on myself so that I have that ability to not get caught up in their emotion. And the emotion is what drags us around. It's the mind. So at the end of the day, if I have the clarity of mind, I hope that I can share that with the student, that certainty and that trust and that knowing that they'll get through it.
Yoga teacher Eileen Hall. If you'd like more info about Eileen, like what actually happens in a Panchakarma, check out the notes in this episode. You'll find links that will lead you to more goodies. I've been having a great time finding more people like Eileen who are doing all kinds of things that are making this world a better place. Like our next guest, the founder of Orange Sky, Nick Marchesi.
That conversation changed all of our lives forever.
If you want to listen to that episode, make sure you subscribe. I'm Siobhan Hunt. See you next time.